20, Ju Young Lee. 22, Xiong Min Kim. 29, Zhang Han Yu. 27, Chang Wu Park. 39, Han So Bing. 63, Se Kim An. 65, Restless Genseng. 72, Xiong Huan Bei. 77, Kyung Hoon Seo. 97, Max Fabre. Head coach for Korea, Choi Jong-hoo.
A very good morning to you and welcome to the OCBC Arena right here in the heart of the Singapore Sports Hub. It's time for us to launch into an all-new event, and this, of course, is the Men's World Floorball Championship Qualifiers 2022, which comes under the AOFC. That's the Asia-Oceania Floorball Championships. We've still got a bit of time before we can get ahead with the game itself. It will be Korea taking on the Philippines in the first match of the day. My name is Glenn Mascarenhas, and with me, it's Imad Akhtar to take you through this entire event, the first one of the day. So, Imad, looking bright for us, the contest ahead, and what do you feel about the Men's Floorball Championships? It's going to be really intense and it's going to be really aggressive.
Absolutely, Glenn, spot on. First of all, it's a privilege to be here at the OCBC Arena witnessing this competition. This event being brought to you by Kin Productions, hosted by the Singapore Floorball Association with support of Sports Singapore, have done a tremendous amount of work to get this off the ground, and of course brought to you online by One Play Sports. Yeah, absolutely, Glenn. I think it promises to be a fine battle. We've got this match coming up, and of course three to follow as well. This qualifier marking the return of top-level men's floorball to the region for the first time since 2019, following the disruptions brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic. We've got four matches today, and the round-robin phase obviously set to last 3 days. The group winners will advance straight to the final of the qualifier and earn a place at the Men's World Floorball Championships to be held later this year in Switzerland. So plenty at stake, and it just promises to be a wonderful day.
Absolutely. So 36 teams normally register for the event, with 16 going through. We have four from here. So as you mentioned, the top two teams will go through, but the second place teams will have to play it off with the third team of the opposing group. So two groups in there. And Imad, I'm going to let you take those two groups. We've got Group G and Group H.
Yeah, we have Group G and Group H. In Group G we have Australia, Japan, Korea, and the Philippines. So immediately following this match, we will have Australia versus Japan. Sorry, I beg your pardon. Australia versus Japan will be at 4 p.m. today. And Thailand, New Zealand, Singapore, and Malaysia, they'll all be in action today as well. From 1:30, Thailand take on New Zealand. And the last match this evening from 6:30 p.m., the host, Singapore, taking on Malaysia.
This is what I love about the New Zealanders. Did have them here bright and early to actually set up their flag. So they're looking forward to a great event as well. Will be interesting to see the New Zealand team perform. Now, the interesting part is that, Imad, the one common thread I think that exists in every single team that's, you know, taking part, not just in the men's, even in the women's, you have European players in there. You've got, you know, Swedes, you've got players from Finland. And I think that's very interesting when you look at the way the floorball actually started off. It started off in Europe, started off in Sweden, and it's that Swedish influence is still there, with, you know, pockets of Finland, Norway, and Czechoslovakia also, you know, being spread around the world. So interesting contest, and the Philippines team has most of the lads born and bred and groomed in the game in Sweden.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's funny you mentioned that, because it was only in 2019 at the Asia-Oceania Floorball Confederation Tournament, which was hosted by the Philippines, that they started recruiting Philippines with links to Sweden in a bid to improve their performance. And in that tournament, they actually finished bronze by beating Korea in the third-place playoff. So the two sides meeting again this afternoon. Given that Philippines have progressed from that stage 5 years on, it should be an interesting battle. Let's see if the Koreans have it in them to take some sweet revenge.
Sounds like it. Now we've got the Korean Republic. They've just walked onto the court. They will be followed by Team Philippines. And then, of course, we will have the national anthem. So do stay with us right here at the OCBC Arena.
Please remain standing for the national anthem for Korea. Please take your seats.
Just gonna get you acquainted with the referees. That's Hidayat Fahar and Prianto Yonki, who are our two referees for the first game of the day. And as the strains come in off, I don't know if you can hear it, it's always a good welcome. Thunderstruck by AC/DC. Just love that opening line. Very interesting, of course, to look at our starting lineups first. And let's start with Korea.
Yep, so the Koreans lining up the forwards. We have Rasmus Janssen and Melvin Parbrand. Occupying the center, Max Parbrand. And occupying the defensive line, Kang In, the skipper, and Ade Eriksson. In goal, An Se-yun.
Time to look at Team Philippines. And we'll get that to you in just a little bit. Philippines, of course, are being led by Captain Lucas Oywell Perez. And in goal, they do have Victor Lindbergh. We've also got Frederick Jepsen Escobel, who is going to be in forward position, along with Melvin Am Mendoza. Ludwig Hemingberg Porrell and Lucas Oywill, the captain, of course, take up defensive positions.
Yeah, Glenn, you did a fair bit of commentary last week at the women's AOFC, and the Philippines were quite an impressive outfit, weren't they?
Oh, they certainly were. Very organized. Got a couple of, a lot of the young ladies, of course, do play top level of floorball in Sweden. And I think that's really the key in this, right? You're looking at players who've been exposed to really, really stiff contests abroad. And I think they carry that through. They bring it out or they put it on display in the game. So left to be seen whether that happens here today, because most of these lads, especially the lads who do play for the Philippines, do play for clubs in Sweden. And, you know, you're playing day in and day out. And just to draw an analogy, it's almost like you'd definitely be a good cricketer if you play county cricket. So Philippines here will feature Victor Lindbergh in the goal. You've got Kim Franz Varga, who will be in the center. Lucas Oywell Perez, the captain, along with Ludwig Hemingberg, will be in defense. And Melvin Mendoza and Frederick Jepsen Escobel will be as forwards. And the face-off. Korea winning possession first. They'll be very eager to, well, attack, get the lead here. They do know how strong Team Philippines is. And I think that's the interesting bit when you talk about these teams. Strike first when the iron is hot. That would be, I think, Korea's game plan. Keep in mind the fact that the Philippines, I did watch them warming up and very organized, very sharp with their passing skills as well. Korea relying heavily on speed. You've got Rasmus.
Yeah, the Koreans themselves have a few imports from Sweden. Not as many as the Philippines, of course, but certainly, if I were in their position, it makes a lot of sense given that, you know, the origins and the provenance of this sport lie in that part of the world, and why not take advantage of it? That said, you do want to build a solid local backbone and ensure that, you know, the growth of the sport in these respective countries remains healthy.
Well, absolutely, but I think there's always, floorball is just kind of still dominated by, you know, the European fans more than anything else, and I think that purely boils down to the fact that the support that the players get, the teams get, not only from sponsors or from fans, is really huge there, and it's only a matter of time before, you know, that actually happens in Asia, and I do believe there's always a chance that maybe an Asian team or a Southeast Asian team will just be up there. If Korea can be the world's number one baseball team and Holland can be one of the top teams in hockey, I think anything is possible because those sports, of course, took, you know, birth in other places. So having said that, well, Asia slowly on the rise. Quick movement there from Korean Hwan Seung-baek, but pulled away in time by Rodel Esquero. We've got a change coming on and the captain's return back to the court. That is Lucas Perez.
Yeah, it seems most of the possession thus far has been with the Koreans. Philippines perhaps need to recalibrate and slow things down a little. The Koreans have played very positively thus far. Obviously no breakthrough. We're in the third minute of the first 15, of course, three periods of 15 minutes. And it's one of the most high-tempo sports I've ever witnessed from close quarters as well, which makes it highly exciting for the fans and those tuning in.
Adi Eriksson trying to pull things through. Just as, well, Imad, you mentioned, yeah, I think a lot has to do with the rolling substitutions as well, and that just... It keeps coming at you. I mean, that's exactly how the sport is played out.
Yeah, absolutely. It keeps minds fresh, legs fresh. And, of course, allows the game to be played at a very decent pace.
Well, it does. Christopher Holland sending it back to, well, his defender. It's Holland back again. We'll try and find his way through, and that's the first shot straight off the post. Fairly good shot there from Matias Cortez. And just an early warning for the Koreans.
Yeah, that came completely against the runner play. It was a very fine effort, but unfortunately, striking the post. Going just wide, but good intent from the Philippines. I like how they've picked up the pace here. Seem to have shrugged off those early nerves.
Well, one of the key elements I think that the Philippines team does use is it's this wait and watch idea, and that's saved. No way through. Bas Young, Victor Lindberg. So Korea with the reply. The Koreans, of course, also being very cautious. They're quick to fall back in defense. They do know that the Philippines team is fairly aggressive, and that's another shot taken, and this time kept away by Han Se-yoon. So just testing the waters there. It was Melvin Portland.
Oh, another attempt by that was Korea's number 97, Max Parbrin, just going over the post, over the crossbar on that occasion. It's actually a golden chance for the Koreans to take an early lead, probably the best chance thus far, but they weren't able to convert on that occasion. Now the Philippines attempting to attack, but thwarted by the Korean defense, which have been pretty stellar thus far, Glenn.
Well, I think the Koreans also fairly organized. They've come in with a plan. They know the opponents. They know who they're up against. Got a couple of lads in there who are fairly crafty with their skills. including Melvin Patron. I do believe that the boys might be related for certain. Melvin Parbrand and Max Parbrand. And absolutely, well, they definitely, well, might be related. We'll find out a bit later. We actually go down and ask them. Well, it's not uncommon for siblings to be playing the same sport, and that too at a very high level. We do have the Anderson siblings as well, and their father, who's a part of the coaching team, Kenneth Anderson. We saw young Luella in action last week. Oh, that stuck beautifully. Looking for a way through, very smartly done there by Kim Varga. It's corner for Korea.
Yeah, very smartly done indeed. The skill level and the stick work from both sets of players has been quite exemplary this morning thus far. I think
Frederick Jepson just missing out on the connect right in front from the center. Could have actually made a difference here, but beaten by the bounce. I didn't think that could happen in floorball too often. But sometimes with the pace of the game itself, your decision-making is just split second, or it's really that fast, or whether you got to pass it, whether you got to shoot it, or whether you actually will control it and dribble.
Yeah, Koreans have used the flanks and the backboards pretty well as well to maintain the stranglehold on possession here.
Looking for that wraparound a couple of times over, rightfully said, Ahmad. We've seen Melvin Pabran will try and come around a couple of times and would like to score from the wrap. But yes, team captain of the Philippines. And that's Melvin Mendoza. Oh, sorry, not Melvin Mendoza, but Lucas Perez. And Lucas Perez, of course, has now swapped places to make way for his teammates. Well, it's still fairly early in this game. It's only the first period. Remember, we have three periods of 15 minutes. Just barely done with the first half of that first period.
Yeah, there was another attempt for the Philippines. A cutback for Matias Cortez Mile Perkio. But he spooned that one over the crossbar. So both sides have created fairly decent chances for themselves, but haven't managed to convert. And you don't want that to come back and bite them later on in the game. But obviously, as you said, Glenn, still early doors at the moment. Philippines, oh, with another attempt, sidestepping the goalkeeper. Let's confirm who that was. I think that was the number 66 again, Cortez Mile Perkio. Relentless pressure on the Korean goal being applied by the Philippines at the moment.
And that's straight through. What an absolutely glorious effort there. Comes in from Rasmus Janssen. A lovely setup by Parbrand. So Max Parbrand just finding his way through to send it across to his teammate. And super, superb effort from Rasmus Janssen. It's now 1-0 Korea. So just, well, seizing the initiative first. And I think that's really important in this. The Koreans were very eager to knock one in. And that's 1-0 Team Korea.
Yeah, absolutely. What a superb goal. He took his time, sized up the goalkeeper, and just unleashed with absolute thumping power. The wrist work was superb. And he gets a deserving rest for his efforts.
He does. He'll be back on soon. I'm sure hunting his brace down in no time. Well, the rolling substitutions always keep you going, don't they? Because sometimes you see players actually netting a hat-trick, and that's really odd because they're on court one moment, they're not, then they come in and score, and they're gone again, and yeah, then they're back into score.
That being said, I'm sure Rasmus Janssen would have loved to have stayed on now that the adrenaline was coursing through his veins after that goal. But
so that's the interesting bit, was just having a chat. Well, keeping the area safe there for the time being. That's, of course, Victor Lindbergh. So otherwise, Lindbergh, that's An Se-yoon for Korea. Philippines, of course, very quick to reply. So was just talking about that whole rest period and, you know, losing momentum. And I think Mr. Floorball, as we call him, Siazni, who was with us last week, well, he's going to be in again this week as well for to keep us company. And he mentioned a very key aspect of this sport about the rest period, and said it really is timed such that you don't feel that loss of momentum, you don't lose that energy, or, you know, the flow is still there. And in conversation with Yoshan, who is a Singapore floorballer, she said, if it was about 30 seconds to a minute that you're, you know, out of court, it's not that bad. Anything over 60 seconds for her would result in you actually getting into a bit of a rest state, and that's bad. So I think 30 seconds to a minute, well, that's what the rolling substitutions happen within. So I guess it works beautifully. I've never experienced that in a sport, because we played sports that are, well, different. I played sports where you can take your time and think, like football and cricket, and, well, this is fast. It's really fast. It's really pacey. Having said that, well, time has moved on. We're into the last 5 minutes of play.
Yeah, that's a very interesting nugget of information that you raised there, Glenn. I mean, like you said, in sports like football and cricket, 30 seconds to a minute is really nothing at all. But in floorball, you know, it's 1/15th of your first period. And so it's a significant chunk of time. And the game moves at a fair clip while you're warming the substitute seats. So very interesting indeed to hear that from former national players.
Lindbergh there with an one-arm save. Lovely shot from Max Barbrin. Barbrin, second time around. And it is Lindbergh who'll win that battle.
Yeah, Victor Lindbergh has certainly been really impressive between the sticks, and has probably been the sole reason behind why Korea leading one and perhaps not three or four at this stage. That was a fine save with his right hand. Very quick reflexes. That was obviously, you mentioned Mr. Floorball Siazni and Yue Shuan, who is a fine exponent of her craft in the Singapore women's defense. They both also spoke about how, you know, the goalkeepers in the sport can often be unsung heroes. You know, we typically focus on the attackers, the scorers, the defensive lines, but the keepers lugging all that heavy gear around as well. They've got to be, you know, they're constantly, I guess, anticipating where the ball might arrive. They're the last line of defense, and of course, key to the organization of their formation at the back. Just such a crucial position that is often overlooked.
So here's a good bit to look forward to. Last week, had the joy of having Singapore men's floorball team goalkeeper Jared Tan, who was with me, and got his entire perspective on, you know, everything about the goalkeepers, including the training, you know, the mental makeup, conditioning. And he's going to be with us this week as well, so it'll be exciting to get him back on board. And just for the record, if you didn't know this, Imad, he's actually a biology teacher by day.
Wow.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
That is very cool. And that's very cool.
It's one of the bits of floorball, apparently, around the world. You have lawyers, you have, you know, stockbrokers, you have startup owners, and they all play ball professionally.
This actually reminds me of the Irish cricket team.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I remember a couple of them did, you know, some very difficult manual labor jobs like plumbing, construction.
Or the Iceland football team, where so many were farmers, and that, how cool was that?
And they've pulled off a couple of upsets on the biggest stage as well. So
massive, massive, yeah. I think it was the previous Euros or the Euros that went by.
I think they gave England a scare, didn't they?
Oh, they did. They certainly did. So one of the bits of floorball, most floorballers, of course, are really participants are very, very passionate about the sport. Pabrind, of course, has to deviate from Lindbergh. Did want to take that shot, but he does in the end. And these two are just becoming thorns in the side of the Philippine defense. That's Pabrind and Rasmus. They've been at it for quite a bit. Having said that, Team Philippines are looking to attack.
Yeah, look, I think the Philippines would be fairly satisfied with how they've played this morning in the first period.
Well, that's touch and go. Absolutely marvelous, isn't it?
It's another superb save by Victor Lindbergh.
And that was the Pabrinds in action. Well, Rasmus Janssen just coming out of nowhere with that. Quick reflexes from the Philippines goalkeeper. Now pulled away by Esquera. So Esquera back again. So just barely a minute, and Imad, time has just flown.
Absolutely has. I mean, like I said, the Philippines, I think, despite being behind, will still go into the first break with some silver linings.
Oh, that's a wonderful save. Absolutely wonderful save by the Korean goalkeeper. Almost nudged in there by Michael Hedblom. Well, those tap-ins, so important in floorball, aren't they?
Absolutely, and again, just an indicator of how good the two keepers have been.
I think we often say right place at the right time, but in floorball, it's not the case. That's just expected. It's just a few seconds shy of hitting the 15 here at the OCBC Arena. It's Imad Akhtar and me, Glenn, taking you through the first game of this event, which is Team Korea and Team Philippines facing off. Now, let's not forget, we will run you through the highlights just to give you a view of what transpired. And that's pretty much it. End of the first period. The Korean Republic will be happy, I think, with their current score. But Team Philippines, expect them to make a comeback real soon in the second period. So for now, let's give you a view of what transpired in this event. And then it'll be time for us to take a break before Imad and me return for the second period. And that's our score at the end of the first period. Korea 1, Philippines 0. Time for the highlights. Thank you. those highlights for you. Let's give you a goal scorer as well. It's Rasmus Janssen, who scored just a little after 8 minutes. And the score, of course, is Korea 1, Philippines 0 at the end of the first period. We'll join you for the second period in just a little bit. So our advice, don't go anywhere. Let's bring it all back to the OCBC Arena at the Singapore Sports Hub. It's time for us to get ahead with the second period of this qualifier, which is the Men's World Floorball Championship qualifier 2022 AOFC. My name is Glenn Mascarenhas, and with me it's my good buddy Imad Akhtar, and we are here to take you through the second period of play. Very interesting. Let's quickly recap that first period. Imad, is it what you were expecting, Korea to take the lead, or did you think that it would have been a little more balanced?
Yeah, look, honestly, Glenn, I think it was going to be a little bit more balanced, but that being said, I think the Koreans took advantage of the chance that came their way. Rasmus Janssen with an absolutely firecracker of a goal to put the Koreans in front. As I was mentioning during the first period, I think the Philippines' attack was pretty strong, and I think they had plenty of opportunities themselves, but, you know, they were thwarted by An Se-yun in the goal. In fact, even their own keeper, Victor Lindberg, was fantastic between the sticks. So all in all, I think it was a fantastic half. I think we could have seen more goals, but it's also down to both sides' stellar defenses.
Now, I do believe that the Philippines would have also sat back just a little bit to try and figure out what the Koreans' game plan is. And I do believe that that's been the plan of even the girls' team when they played last week. So I think the interesting part is now in the second period. Will Philippines step it up? They'll be eager to equalize. Or will they, of course, still play cautious? And I do believe that at some level it also helps where you're defense heavy and you take those opportunities in attack. Will that be the case in the second period? We'll find out.
Yeah, you bang on there, Glenn. You know, when I was doing some commentary for the national school games here, I did speak to one of the coaches. It might have been Shazni himself, who mentioned that most teams like to sit back and hit on the counter. And he was saying 60% of goals scored in floorball are scored on the counter. So I thought that was an interesting nugget of information. And the Philippines might follow suit in the second period.
So it is going to be interesting. And we will find out how that pans out here. Past the face-off and into that second period of play. Let's keep in mind the fact that, of course, this event has eight teams in the contest. Only four will progress to the World Floorball Championships. We've got two groups in there, just as Imad, of course, did inform us earlier. It's in Group G. We've got Australia, Japan, Korea, Philippines, and in Group H, we've got Thailand, Singapore, New Zealand, and Malaysia. It's also interesting to know that 36 teams registered for the event, and we did have China registering as well just recently, a while back. So it's going to be interesting to see which of these four teams will make it through to join the 16 that will qualify for the World Floorball Championships. Having said all that, they've had 13 so far. Sweden has won 9. Finland have won 4. And strangely, the only two other runners-up have been Switzerland and was it Norway or Czechoslovakia? I think it was Norway. Those are the only other two teams who have finished as runners-up, which is fairly well, fairly one-sided, if you ask me.
Absolutely.
But the Swedes dominated. They played, they love it, they're passionate about it, and I think Finland, Czechoslovakia, Switzerland. Well,
yeah, and interestingly, obviously the Swiss qualify automatically this year, given that they're the host nation. The Ivory Coast is participating in the European qualifiers for just the second time in a row, and then the only team from Africa to ever participate in the World Floorball Championship qualifiers. India will be participating in the qualifiers for the first time since 2010. What do you think about that, Glenn?
Well, I think that's interesting because, I have figured that it's a game that would come, or sport that would come naturally to, you know, the Indians because of hockey. Having said that, the technique of course totally differs because I've always felt that, you know, floorball is kind of a hybrid of hockey and ice hockey at the same time. You know, there's different rules, there's different technical skills. But I do believe that one of the positives that the Indian team has is even though they're not as experienced as some of the other floorball teams, they can score. And they somehow or the other manage to score and to actually keep progressing. So it will be interesting to see them in action this time around.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, the sport has grown leaps and bounds, certainly since it was first introduced way back when, decades ago. In Singapore itself, it was introduced in 1994 and 96. The Singaporeans sent its first national team to compete in the first World Floorball Championships in Sweden. You know, the Singapore Floorball Association has done a tremendous amount of work even here to manage the development and promotion of the game to more than 15,000 players. There's about 200 clubs. 200 schools, you know, so it's done a, you know, and like I said, during the NSG, there was a lot of floorball taking place as well. So it's great to see the sport take off from such a young level.
I think the joy that exists in the Singapore Floorball Association is the fact that they picked up the sport very early compared to a lot of other countries. I did watch, the Singapore women's team in action. Was absolutely delighted by their performance. Of course, not taking any credit away from the Philippines women's team as well, but just to reflect on how Singapore did get this ball rolling and then, you know, it spread to the other Southeast Asian countries. A lot of the Malaysian players, bred in Singapore, and they've actually honed in on their skills here. The same for Team Philippines. Jade Rivera, the Philippines team captain, used to play in Singapore, and she's really good mates with most of our floor ballers. And that, of course, will be a misdemeanor right behind. Well, Max Parbrand goes down, and it's Ludwig Hemmingberg who was right behind. Of course, Philippines will get the benefit of this call as Holland gets ready to take that corner. Close enough opportunity here for the Philippines, and I think Imad, this is one where they'll be eager to grab it by the horns. But the Koreans, well, just clearing the danger rather quickly.
Yeah, exactly. I think the Koreans.
Oh, that's a beautiful effort! Absolutely marvelous! Rodel Esquera coming in from the left, took it from an angle, a lovely passing shot, gets it into the corner of that goal, does it beautifully. Well, that's what you needed. It's a flash of brilliance, and it's one all back again at the OCBC arena.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant crossfield ball across to Rodel Esquera. The balance, the poise, and the finish were absolutely spot on, and he brings the Philippines back on parity. This is a riveting tie. 3 minutes and 44 seconds into the second period, we are now back all square.
Well, I just do believe that the Korean defense just exposed there for a little bit. They weren't expecting that shot, and I think that's the joy of floorball, to be able to, well, do it on the trot, to be able to take shots on impulse. And I think what works best is that change of direction when, you want to score a goal, and you have to get the better of the opposition's defenders mentally. And I think this time around, Esquera did absolutely well.
Yeah, as you mentioned, he just exploited that loophole in the Korean defense, which, has been pretty impressive thus far. But like you said, it's just small margins for error, especially in a sport like this, where, you need to be on it. Your A game needs to be brought to the table at every moment, failing which you concede goals like you just did. But full credit again to Rodel Esquera, not taking anything away from that effort, which was absolutely astounding.
And the Philippines, well, really pressing in that Korean defense area. That's another shot. Absolute magic there from young Melvin Mendoza. It's now 2-1, and this is what the Philippines did do in the first period. They sat easy for just a little bit. They were struck by surprise, but yeah, they've come back. It's now 2-1. Well, now the tables have turned, and it's left to the Korean Republic and the lads in blue to level the score. Having said that, it's just about barely 5 minutes into the second period, but two goals already.
Yeah, I think this is, the Philippines men have come out guns a-blazing in the second period, completely unexpected on the part of the Koreans. As you mentioned, Glenn, earlier, strike while the iron is hot. I think you used that phrase early in the first period. This is exactly what the Philippines have done, and Koreans are somewhat shell-shocked. They're going to have to recalibrate and perhaps re-strategize, certainly, plug some of those holes at the back, because that second one really shouldn't have gone in.
Well, I think it was smart play from the Philippine forwards as well. They did set it up. They had a screener used as well, and that's what made a bit of a difference, and I think absolutely beaten there or taken by surprise was the Korean keeper, Han Se-yoon. Esquerra just finding Hedblom. Hedblom gets it around the goal. Well, that's absolutely quick. Lovely play there. Try to tap that in. A great teamwork. Lovely passing skills as well, but Kim Varga unable to get it past Han Se-yoon.
This looks a very different Philippines lineup. They're certainly supercharged after those two goals. They're looking to make merry here and just capitalize on the momentum that they've managed to drum up.
Well, Team Korea will be very eager to get that goal as soon as possible, because keep in mind the fact that, well, they wouldn't want the Philippines to get ahead with too big a lead. Let's not forget that Philippines have had their fair share of trials in the sport itself, starting way back from 2014. They've suffered heavy defeats over the years, and it's been a huge progress for them. I don't know how exactly it pans out when you do get foreign talent in, but who have the same blood, or you've got a lineage connected there regarding nationality. But I think that's, in a way, it's also fantastic. It also helps a lot of the lads who've been born and brought up abroad to actually reconnect with their own culture, with their own roots. And I think that's so important. And these lads are loving it. They absolutely love it. I did see it with many of the women's teams as well. So, heartwarming year for the Philippines and the growth of floorball, and we are all for that.
Absolutely. I mean, you took the words out of my mouth. From the moment they started making their debut at the 2014 Southeast Asian Floorball Championships, which was actually hosted here in Singapore, they lost all four of their games against the Indonesians, the Malaysians, and Singapore themselves.
And they were big defeats.
If I recall correctly, yeah, absolutely. They then went on to the 2017 Floorball Confederation Tournament in Bangkok 3 years later with no prior victory in an international match, and came away with a 4-3 victory over China. And that really kick-started their journey. And from then on, as you rightly mentioned, Glenn, they brought a lot of these foreign players in. And I'm all for it. If the Swedes and the Finns are the ones leading the charge in the sport, then what better way to sort of improve your game than to bring them into the side, and culturally assimilate them. And I think the Philippines are the best example, perhaps one of the best in the world, really, of that notion.
I totally agree with you, Mad. I'm all for the growth of any sport, and if you got to do what it takes, hey, why not? And well, this is a sport that is growing in the Asian region. Surprisingly, it grew first in Southeast Asia, and thanks Singapore for that. And then it spread to other parts of Asia too. Now so many Asian teams involved in playing the sport, and India of course would have never, I never thought that it ever pick it up, keeping in mind the fact that you don't have too many courts. You've got more open fields where you can play a game like hockey. But having said that, not just floorball, but even futsal for that matter now, has been picking up in leaps and bounds in India.
Yeah, it's good to see. And obviously, being originally from Pakistan myself, when I was doing a little bit of research ahead of this tournament, I noticed that they'd also participated in one of the Continental Cups in floorball, and it was not what I expected, as you said, because of the grounds that they have. You'd expect more popularity and more of their youngsters gravitating towards the likes of hockey, sports that they've dominated over the years, sports in which they've got a great foundation. But again, there's no harm in expanding your horizons and learning a new sport. And I think the Pakistanis and the Indians have certainly done that.
So while, of course, we certainly focus on the growth of the sport, and that makes us happy, let's also bring you back to the score. It's still Philippines 2, Korea 1, 9 minutes, 20 seconds in. There's still, of course, no change as far as the scoreline is concerned for the last couple of minutes, but Korea will be very, very keen on doing that. A lovely effort there once again from Rasmus Janssen, but Victor Lindberg says, not this time, buddy.
Yeah, absolutely bang on, Glenn. I think Rasmus Janssen was trying to do exactly what he did the first time around, but on this occasion, Victor Lindberg was up to the task and ensured that Korea didn't get the equalizer there.
Straight back to Adi Eriksson. Well, the Philippine defense will be very keen on trying to keep the Koreans out of that area. The Korean defense will be even more keen on keeping the Philippines out of their goal area. The change of pace in the Philippines team is so important. Now here's Young Pabran. Well, losing possession to the Philippines, and that's a beautiful quick run once again. Does it every time, Young Kim Varga. Rasmus Janssen. Well, the referee, of course, has called that. Looks like we might have a delayed penalty. We'll just try and figure that out because play will continue for the time being. Well, the sport as far as floorball is concerned tends to be a lot more aggressive with the men's than with the women's, which tends to pack in a bit of elegance. Here it's more about speed and aggression. Well, once again, the Philippine defense standing up there to keep that attack from Rasmus Janssen at bay. He's had quite a few shots on goal in this part of the period. The referee has finally called it time. And I did mention there was a delayed penalty, so it's going to be Philippines number 16. That is Christian Castrillo, who'll have to sit on the bench for 2 minutes, and Team Korea have got the power play. So interesting bit here. And that was for that collision earlier with Pabrand.
Yeah, the sin bin, they call it. Is that right?
Absolutely.
This is a good chance for the Koreans to find that equalizer in the next couple of minutes. They won't have a better chance, given that they've been up against it for the majority of this second period. I think they'll definitely be looking to capitalize on the advantage, the power play that they've gained. Certainly the Philippines will be hampered by that loss and will have to re-strategize as well.
And the referee, of course, just explaining what transpired to the team. Well, there was a bit of physical activity there in that huge collision earlier, and the referee, of course, let them play on, and just explaining it to the captain. So the power play for Team Korea, 2 minutes. Will they be able to exploit this advantage? And the penalty was for obstruction. We've just got a confirmation there from the officials. So four men for the Philippines, and this is the time when they will try and defend as much as they can. Or they could just play spoil sport and counter-attack, which happens very often in the sport.
Yeah, the Koreans just taking their time here. Back and forth, trying to find open space.
Well, no way through for Junyoung Lee. Well, wanted that shot on goal, and this is exactly what I was talking about, Imad. How, well, you can actually destroy the power play advantage for your opponents by taking the attack to them.
Yeah.
And that's such an interesting theory, isn't it? And also win yourself a free hit in in the whole process. I think well done there by Melvin Mendoza.
Yeah, I think it was, he was sandwiched there by Max Parbrun and Ade Eriksson. And rightly so, the referee gave a free hit, but the Koreans now back in possession. Just under a minute of 50 seconds to go of this power play. Really, probably this is the attack that they need to convert.
Rasmus Janssen once again with another shot on goal, but Victor Lindberg, of course, has started to read him exceptionally well, and he's been able to keep up most of the attacks by Janssen after that solitary goal that he did allow. Trouble times for Ante Yoon, but he's kept his ground. So as we get to that 13-minute period, let me, of course, remind you that this is the Men's World Floorball Championships qualifier 2022 and AOFC, which means, of course, this covers the Asia-Oceania region, which is why we will see New Zealand in action in just a little bit as well. Well, most of the lads do pack in a lot of pace here, Imad, and I think in the second period of play, it's certainly Team Philippines who've taken that pace up by, you know, a few notches. Having said that, I do believe Kim Varga, exceptionally standout player when it comes to his dribbling skills. He's probably the fastest we've seen on the court this morning. And the number 44, the Philippines, exemplary with his skills.
Yeah, Varga has certainly been the standout player this morning. And he's given his side plenty of impetus from the center. Really the foundation, the rock, the bedrock of the Philippines lineup. He's really controlled play and dictated play from that center position. As you rightly mentioned, his fitness level's right up there with some of the top floorball players around the world. Of course, these guys put in so many hours behind the scenes. Low center of gravity that they need to keep. The skills, you know, a lot of the... We didn't speak much about injuries, but last week when both of us were commentating alongside Yoshuan, suffered an ACL tear, and she was also speaking about the large number of injuries that players take to the lower extremities, like the knees or the ankles. And certainly because of the high tempo of the sport, it is a very common occurrence, and so fitness is paramount.
It is. So into the last 10 seconds of the second period, and the Philippines, of course, have dominated this period entirely. Team Korea really eager to get back into it, but there'll always be a third period. So at the end of the second period, it's Team Philippines 2, Team Korea 1. We will, of course, run you through moments of the second period before we can get down to giving you the scorers' names. And then finally, a small break before we get into the third and final period. So if you thought it was going to be fast, and if you thought it was going to be really exciting, well, you got that right as far as this event is concerned. So Imad Akhtar and me, Glenn, still taking you through the rest of the first game. But first up, it's time for us to get straight ahead with the highlights. And the score once again for you, Korea 1, Philippines 2, and a look back. Here at the side of the table, please jump in. So those were the highlights for us. Of course, let's very quickly remind you that we had two excellent goals scored in that period of play. Those were our goal scorers, Rodel Esquera with the equalizer just over 18 minutes, and then Melvin Mendoza just before the 20-minute mark had scored that lead for the Philippines. So it's Korea 1, Philippines 2 at the end of the second period. Korea 1, Philippines 2. And we will be back with you in just a little bit when the third period resumes. So it's Imad Akhtar and me, Glenn, still with you at the OCBC Arena. And of course, we'd love it if you don't go anywhere and just stay with us. Once again, the score, Korea 1, Philippines 2. into the third and final period of the first game. That is Philippines and Korea locked in the battle here in the World Championship qualifiers. This is, of course, the men's World Floorball Championship qualifiers, 2022 AOFC. And by AOFC, we purely mean Asia, Oceania. Started off, of course, really well as far as Korea are concerned. They won the first period 1-0 before Philippines did register a massive comeback with a 2-1 scoreline at the end of the second period. Into the third and final period, it's all left for Korea to do here and to get back on level terms, or it just might be Philippines to attack once again. My name is Glenn Mascarenhas, and with me it's my good buddy Imad Akhtar, and we are taking you through the first event of the day. Let's not forget that we will be with you right till the last event of the Floorball Championships qualifiers, and that happens on Saturday. So, to be fair, you can't get rid of us.
Absolutely right, Glenn. As we kick off the start of the third period, the match has, well, really been a seesaw affair. The Koreans led in the first period, and then the Philippines struck back two goals in quick succession at the start of the second, and have looked in the ascendancy ever since. They were a man down. The Koreans had a power play advantage towards the end, the back end of the second period, but weren't able to capitalize. I saw the Koreans training, well, focusing on their passing during this second break. Perhaps that's an area in which they want to improve on.
So that's interesting because, you know, the Philippines, of course, I think would have had a change as far as the strategy is concerned coming into the second period. But what I'd really like to know is what the talk was during that break with the Koreans. They would have definitely had, you know, a plan in mind coming into this period of play. And I think we'll probably see that being executed here, depending on how the lads perform. The Pabran boys, once again in action. I did not think about it. You have the Hari boys and detective novels and the Pabran boys in football. They could be a brand by themselves. Excellent athletes. Having said that, I mean, didn't mean to take the mickey in them, but absolutely wonderful athletes.
It's a fine play on words, Glenn. You weren't a poet in a previous life, were you?
I certainly wasn't. So back to the action here. It's just about a minute and a half in, so we aren't going to call it. Matter of fact, we can't call the result at any point of time in Floorball. But having said that, I do believe that the Koreans trying to take this game to the Philippines. I do believe that the Philippines are just about outpacing them that tad bit, Imad. They've just got that pace advantage when it comes to, you know, dribbling through or those passes, or more importantly, those runs that the lads have been taking on court.
Yep. I think you're right there, Glenn. In the first period, we didn't see that advantage, but it's certainly grown as the match has worn on. And, you know, the Koreans, as you said, have been on the back foot a little. The game has gotten a little bit more physical since the second period as well. We've seen a couple of misdemeanors, a couple of fouls have been committed. And perhaps on the part of the Koreans, because of that pace advantage that the Philippines have, they've had to stop them and obstruct them, you know. So that's a very good point that you mentioned.
I do believe that. And the Korean defense, you know, for the last 10 or 12 minutes of this encounter, they've been more in that defense area. They know that the Philippines are going to attack. But I do believe that will also put them at a disadvantage because Philippines are just that kind of team that you give them, you know, an inch and they'll take a mile in your area, you know, of the court.
Yep. Absolutely. I mean, that's what they did with the two goals scored by Rodel Esguera and Melvin Mendoza. Small lapses in the Korean defense, and they were quick to pounce on it and make the most of those chances to give the Philippines a deserving lead.
But just my opinion, of course, I do believe Esguera's goal, bang on the money. Absolutely one for the photo books there.
Yeah, it was a superb goal. And really nicely set up as well by Matisse Cortez. The crossfield ball pinpoint accuracy and a shot from the left.
So Philippines, of course, now playing with six lads on field, with Lindbergh having come off. So, well, just a plan, yeah. And Lindbergh will get back on in just a little bit, and he already is back. Well, needed to get a sip of water as well. And it's not often, really, that the goalkeepers do get, you know, substituted. So I do believe that they'd love to hydrate every now and then. And it's, you don't see a change in keeper too often. Normally, the keeper will stay the length of the period, or at least the length of the game as well. But the players do get the benefit of, you know, stepping back out and stepping back in, resting a bit.
Yeah, you know, Lindbergh, not only does he possess tremendous skill, but he's also got a swagger about him with those nice flowing long locks.
Well, I do believe that. Yes, he does. I did have a women's player who had that swagger last week, and I was very impressed with that. She's the Malaysian goalkeeper, Michaela, who just had that walk, and it was very impressive. I do believe there's always a standout quality of most players who display some sort of flamboyance. And then you have other players who just are hardworking and go about it like a regular job. Well, that's got to be the Philippines once again in full flow. And this is exactly what they've been looking for. They've been looking for those gaps in the Korean defense. And now stepping it up, it's Lucas Castrillo. This is how it all broke down. Now Castrillo was lurking around that area. Lovely setup there, and a beautiful assist coming in from Melvin Mendoza. Well, he did get the ball rolling, and then he was right behind that goal. So perfect assist from Mendoza, and a perfect execution from Christian Castrillo. So 3-1. And it's beginning to look a bit, well, challenging here for the Koreans. It's a good bit of time. Remember, of course, you can come back from 5 or 6 goals in football given a few minutes. But having said that, it's 11 minutes left in this encounter. The Philippines currently lead 3-1 over Team Korea. I do believe now, of course, that the Philippines will be very eager to keep the pressure on the Koreans. They know that the Koreans have been pegged back. And I think this is the part where Korea will really have to dig deep. They've got to get back on level terms. They've got to reduce the deficit first. Will the Philippines allow that? Well, I think that's a golden question now.
Yeah, I think that last goal was another example of that extra bit of pace that the Philippines possess. You know, the Korean defense was caught napping. It was Max Parbrand, in fact, who wasn't able to mark the goal scorer, Christian Castrillo. And the Philippines took advantage, and certainly they've got the game by the scruff of the neck at the moment. And with just 10 minutes left of play, regulation time in this final period, the Koreans will have to reduce that deficit as soon as possible if they stand a chance of restoring parity here.
Well, you just spoke about Victor Lindbergh, and he's got a couple of fans in the stands. The girls love him. I'm not surprised. He's got a bit of a fan following, doesn't he? So that's interesting. Talking of fan following, of course, the crowds will come in, as this event progresses. Let's not forget, one of the reasons why we do have, well, lesser people in the stands is simply because it's no longer WFH. And that's not an expletive, but it's just work from home. And so most people have returned back to their jobs. Let's not forget, it is a weekday. So a lot of Floorball fans will actually be catching it on their small screens or, you know, on the laptop, on their devices. Having said all that, towards the weekend, of course, it does get heavy. So in case you want to get your tickets, don't forget, you should get them in advance, especially for that Friday and Saturday event. Lovely run there from Seongmin Kim, but unable to do much with it. And Team Philippines looking to attack once again. A few worries here for the Koreans, because they've been searching for a way through. Haven't really had a shot on goal, unlike, well, the first two periods. Here's Rasmus off to Addy.
Ali trying to pick his man out. We'll pick out young Pabrant. And that, of course, is Melvin Pabrant. It's Max now. Just had a bit of a collision there with Holland. And we did have Christian. Well, young Christian, of course, who was benched earlier, Castrillo. He's an exciting player too, fairly strong in that defense and center area. Still a good bit of time left him out, and you still think doable year for Team Korea?
Yeah, very much so. Time is on their side, but they've really been outplayed in this period as well, and I think if they are to stand a chance, they're going to really have to press forward, you know, go for the jugular, because I don't see them shoring up the defensive lines, as we've seen a bit of a melee again in the Korean goal. You know, the only route for them is to perhaps do what the Filipinos were doing earlier, sit back and hit on the counter, as they're trying to attempt to do now. But a goal needs to be found soon. It's funny you mentioned earlier, or it's an exciting prospect really for, at least it's witnessed some fans in the stadium. This men's World Floorball Championship qualifier is actually part of the inaugural Singapore Floorball Series, which was launched as a platform that aims to regularly bring top floorball action to the community here. And, you know, the women's AOFC championships last week were also a part of that. So now that, you know, restrictions are being lifted gradually and we see the return of high-level international sport to Singapore, you know, let's hope that this series marks the start of a great period of growth for the sport here in the Lion City.
Well, I'm all for that. And Max Pabrant, of course, just missing out on an opportunity. I do believe, Imad, just as you rightfully mentioned, this sport will grow, and it's, you know, spreading its wings slow and easy. Having said that, I think what really matters more than anything else is really the fans, and if there's something that can make the sport grow, I mean, we've seen that in different events, we've seen that in normally more common sports like football around the world and the growth of it. And well, I think floorball has a very strong chance. It's an exciting sport, it's entertaining, it's super fast, you don't really have time to blink, and I love that when you're down with a sport like that, how interesting does it get. So 8.5 minutes in, we've had a few worries here for Team Korea. Every time that Melvin Mendoza gets behind that goal area and tries to create those opportunities, and he's back on field now. And you also got that super fast lad Varga in there. So I do believe that Philippines will be very eager to strike again. It's certain that they've got a plan in mind. Well, dragging that. Well, past the away post, Varga this time around. He's better with the run than with the long-distance shot, isn't he?
Yeah, he's a live wire, is Kim Varga. And as we've pointed out, not once, but on several occasions, during the course of this match, he's really been the foundation of this Philippine side and allowed them to be in the position they're in at the moment, enjoying a comfortable two-goal cushion into the 10th minute of this final period of play against Korea. The first match, of course, immediately following this, we have Thailand taking on New Zealand. That's a Group H clash. This is, of course, Group G. And then Australia and Japan, the other two sides in Group G, will be facing off at 4 p.m. And finally, the last match pits the host Singapore against Malaysia.
So what's interesting, of course, is as we cruise through this event itself, remember, there's a number of matches, and you could catch all of them. And if you do need to watch them live and get a piece of the action, it's actually even more interesting because you can soak in the atmosphere. Well, do come up to the OCBC Arena. Its tickets are extremely affordable. If it was left to me and I wasn't here in the seat, I'd probably get in my... all my neighbors, just bring them in to enjoy the action.
barely about a little over 5 minutes left in the third period. Philippines still, of course, with a comfortable lead. Let's remind you that this event is being brought to you by Kin, the sports agency, and presented to you online by OnePlay Sports. My name is Glenn Mascarenhas, and with me it's my buddy Imad Akhtar, and we're taking you through the first event in the Men's World Floorball Championship Qualifiers 2022, AOFC. And we've got to mention that because just to recap it, Imad, just four teams from these eight will get into the World Floorball Championships, and only 16 from the 36 registered in the tournament will get to those finals in November. It's going to be interesting. And if you and me probably do get that window, it might be good for us to travel and actually catch the action in Switzerland.
Absolutely. Have to bring a few layers with us as well, because it might be fairly cold at that time of year.
I think it will be, but having said that, I do love the cold. I'm zero, minus two, minus three can probably go till there. It has to do with natural insulation. So not too much of a worry at my end. So into the last 5 minutes, and this is going to be an interesting one. If Korea have to do, they will have to do it now. And I think there's a bit of thought there. The Korean coaching staff are having a quick conversation. They might call for a timeout. It looks like there is a plan in mind, but what is it? Well, that's a tough guess. We've got the Philippines captain on as well, and that's Lindbergh. But adopting that better be safe than sorry. Well, attitude, and he's been impressive. He's been very impressive. I do believe, but Anse Yoon has also done fairly well to keep away a few of those attacks. Was just, I think, exposed a couple of times with his defenders not around, and that's when, you know, the Philippines really got the better of him.
Yeah, both keepers have been pretty standout this morning. Well, now we're into the afternoon, just 15 minutes past 12. But yeah, you know, on a serious note, I guess I'd love to witness the Swedes, who are 9-time gold medalists in the World Floorball Championships, in action. It'd be a great learning curve as well for a lot of these Asian sides who are going to be there, to just have the chance to participate and play against.
Oh. What a shot that is, isn't it? Max Parbrand steps up to the occasion and maximizes, well, his opportunity. What a shot. So it's 3-2. And this is what we said in Floorball. There will be a time for you to come back in, and you just might be able to. But will Philippines be able to hold them off with that slender lead now? So Korea 2, Philippines 3, and it's turning out to be a fight. Lovely effort from Max Parbrand. Were you impressed about?
Very impressed. But I think the Filipinos took the foot off the pedal a little bit there, resting on their laurels, and we saw a pretty exasperated reaction in the background. I'm not sure if you caught it. Melvin Mendoza puts his stick down into the ground in disgust, because he knows that while there are only less than 3 minutes remaining, getting the Koreans back into the game at such a critical stage, you know, makes for a very interesting last few minutes. And I guess as Sir Alex Ferguson, the great Manchester United manager, once coined the term squeaky bum time, heading into that very shortly indeed. And so
absolutely,
I think the Koreans will definitely be going into these last few with a lot more momentum. As you can already see, they're passing the ball around quite swiftly, moving the Filipinos around the court, and remains to be seen whether the Philippines can hold off, I guess, this final attack from the Koreans.
So the Philippines just playing a little bit cautious here. They've stepped back into their defensive area. They know that the Koreans will come at them, but they can safely do that, probably try and defend that lead and then look for that opportunity to attack and restore the two-goal cushion that they had earlier. I think that's really the plan as far as Team Philippines are concerned. Here's Lindbergh. Keeps it low there with that throw. Well, a solo run there. He will be denied this time around by Anse Yoon, but Yves Gelangre does extremely well to get ahead with his effort. A lovely solo run. I do think that Yves was really looking forward to knock that through and probably to restore that lead that Team Philippines had. Here's Barbrand.
It's pushed forward by Kwaning Kang
earlier, the captain. Haven't seen too much of him. Scramble around the goal area there for Team Philippines. That's another bit of danger. Rasmus Janssen. And that's pulled away just in time. Oh, that was a solid effort. Mendonca misses the target, but once again, Varga putting on that pacey run to create that opportunity.
Yeah, Varga was just off like a flash. Picked out Mendoza. Mendoza went for the first time hit. Tried to spoon it over the keeper's head or helmet. And unfortunately wasn't able to get that on target. Just under 2 minutes remaining now of regulation time. About a minute and 44 seconds to go. That's the Philippines holding a slender advantage. Timeout being called, I believe, by the Korean side. Obviously getting their final words, pearls of wisdom.
So as we get into that last bit of play, let's not forget it's Korea 2, Philippines 3. Here is Lindbergh. He's had a good outing. Well, to a certain extent. Well, I did concede those two goals, but then put that down to the brilliance of the lads in blue. Will Korea will finish this off with a draw? That's a big question. Keep in mind the fact that the points are so important in this event. This is not... Well, well done there. Parbrand almost gets it in, but pulled away just in time by the Philippines team captain, Lucas Perez. Perez once again in action. Varga furthering it. Mendonca right behind that goal area.
Philippines will look to play out a bit of time here, and why not? Strategically, probably the right thing to do. Get the Koreans to chase them. Keep possession. Don't try and do anything too extravagant or flamboyant at this stage, because we just have about 50 seconds remaining. Having said that, almost
a slip up from the team captain, wasn't it?
Exactly. Victor Lindbergh there luckily was alert to the danger.
Well, every time these lads do get into that area, especially Varga, Mendoza, and of course young Esquera, they spell T-R-O-U-B-L-E for the Korean side.
Well, given away by the Koreans.
Well, you really can't afford to be making any of those mistakes when you're playing a top-level team like the current Philippines team is, and they will punish you. So into that last 12 seconds of play, and Philippines will definitely try to just hold the Koreans at bay, claim a win in this first event. Let's not forget that win, of course, will contribute towards them making progress to the World Floorball Championships, and it is a win for Team Philippines. Well, the fans are ecstatic here in the stands, and so are their teammates. It's ended Korea 2, Philippines 3. And time very quickly for us to look back, not only at the highlights, but before that, we will have the prize present, or we will have the highlights, and we will have the appreciation for, you know, the best players in this part of the game.
Well, Glenn, I think we've certainly probably already picked our best players. Varga on the Philippines side, the Parbrand brothers on the Korean side, the two keepers as well.
Yeah, and I'd put that down more to Max Parbrand than Melvin. I think he was the number 97. Very, very active. He's absolutely lethal in that opposition's goal area. So will be interesting. And well, let's not forget, along with Varga, you also got Mendoza. Well, he did provide a few of those assists. He was in and around creating all those opportunities for the forwards.
Yeah, and scored a goal himself, I believe, the second one for the Philippines in that second period. So certainly a number of contenders, but ultimately, this being a team sport, everyone's contributed. These are mere formalities, but a good recognition nonetheless for the standout players this afternoon.
Melvin L. Mendoza. The player of the match for Korea will be presented by Mr. Arif Asfar, Tournament Director of Singapore Floorball Association. Now the player of the match from Korea goes to number 97, Max Parbrand.
So we got that right, Imad. I don't think it's going to happen too often in this qualifiers, but this time we got it right. Parbrand and, of course, Mendoza delighting us with their effort. So absolutely delightful matchup, and this is exactly what happened. It all started, of course, with the Koreans taking the lead. And there was a lovely effort there from Rasmus Janssen, who knocked in the first goal to put Korea ahead. Philippines did try to get back as soon as possible, but it was the Koreans, of course, who would dominate that first period of play solely on that single effort.
Yeah, fine effort from Rasmus Janssen, and then the Philippines in the second period came back, guns a-blazing, a renewed strategy, and equalized through Rodel Esguera, number 5.
Well, I think that pass coming in from, Matias Cortez, and then I really wasn't expecting Esguera to take the shot, but beautifully done. Found his way through, and from a tough angle.
Very acute angle that was indeed. And I think it went through his own teammate and a Korean defender and straight into the back of the net.
So that was one all back again, and then Mendoza decided to come calling, found that gap there, found the defense, of course, well, just not lax, but resting a bit, and decided to exploit that lovely effort from Mendoza to make it 2-1. So this is really where Philippines got themselves into the driver's seat in that second period of play. And Mendoza, what an opportunistic goal, wasn't that?
Absolutely. Made no mistake when the opportunity was presented to him. And then, of course, the Philippines increased their lead to 2. With a wonderfully worked goal. I guess the Korean defense was caught napping, but that didn't matter for Christian Castrillo because he was in the right place at the right time.
And once again, that assist from Mendoza. And so he had a goal and he had a brilliant assist. Picked out Castrillo extremely well. Well, knew that there was an absolute chance of them extending their lead. So 3-1.
Absolutely. And then the Koreans pulled one back late on. About 4 minutes before the end of the play. Max Parbrand, the blue shirts, man of the match, player of the match, fittingly scoring a very clinical finish, leaving Victor Lindberg, who was impressive on the day, but he was unable to do anything about that one. Perhaps a little bit of confusion with his number 40 as well. But the Koreans pulled one back, attempted to equalize, but unfortunately weren't able to. The Philippines did have a couple more chances to extend that lead again by 2 goals, but managed to hold on to possession and notch up a first victory in this Group G battle.
Well, I do believe the Philippines, of course, doing everything right in this in this match, and just at the end, even though there was a flash of brilliance there from Max Parbrand, they were able to hold off
the attack. So it did end in favor of Team Philippines. Here are our goal scorers. Rasmus Janssen, of course, opened the scoring for Team Korea in the first period. And then Rodel Esquera and Melvin Mendoza made a 2-1 at the end of the first period in favor of the Philippines before Christian Castrillo decided to add a third goal. But Max Barbrand tried to pull one back for Team Korea. But at the end of the day, it's ended Korea 2, Philippines 3. Well, it's also time to let you know what's coming up. We've got Thailand versus New Zealand. New Zealand that'll take place at 1:30. And it's Imad Akhtar and me, Glenn, who are bringing you this event. Well, don't forget to join us again because we will be with you through the next event. But till then, it's time to take a break. Get yourself something to eat. Get yourself a beverage. And do keep in mind the fact that the action is only going to get hotter than it already is here at the OCBC Arena. Bye for now.